My steps, lilt in my heart, and anticipation in my eyes, I extend my gesture of welcome to you all. If your action creates legacies that inspires others to dream more, learn more, do more, and become more, then you are an excellent leader. A very pleasant morning to all the dignitaries, distinguished industry leaders, chairmen, managing directors, general managers, plant heads, HRMs, principals, HODs, faculty members, training and placement officers. I, Kaushal Khatri, welcome you all to GHR Connect, a gathering of like-minded leaders who have made it here with the purpose of engaging visionaries. Thank you for being here with us today. Before commencing any auspicious event, we have a tradition of seeking the blessings of Goddess Saraswati and our elders by offering them worship. I would request our chief guest, Dr. R.K. Shigavkar, guest of honor, Dr. Dinanath Kolkar, Mr. Ajit Ji Tatia, trustee director, RGI Pune, Mr. Aditya Bhandari, executive director, RGI, Dr. Preeti Bajaj, director, GHRCE, to kindly offer worship and light the traditional lamp. I also request Dr. K.K. Paliwal, Dr. R.D. Kharadkar, Mr. Nagendra Singh to accompany them. Bring in my steps, lilt in my heart, and anticipation in my eyes, I extend my gesture of welcome to you all. If your action creates legacies that inspires others to dream more, learn more, do more, and become more, then you are an excellent leader. A very pleasant morning to all the dignitaries, distinguished industry leaders, chairmen, managing directors, general managers, plant heads, HRMs, principals, HODs, faculty members, training and placement officers. I, Kaushal Khatri, welcome you all to GHR Connect, a gathering of like-minded leaders who have made it here with the purpose of engaging visionaries. Thank you for being here with us today. Before commencing any auspicious event, we have a tradition of seeking the blessings of Goddess Saraswati and our elders by offering them worship. I would request our chief guest, Dr. R.K. Shigavkar, guest of honor, Dr. Dinanath Kolkar, Mr. Ajit Ji Tatia, trustee director, RGI Pune, Mr. Aditya Bhandari, executive director, RGI, Dr. Preeti Bajaj, director, GHRCE, to kindly offer worship and light the traditional lamp. I also request Dr. K.K. Paliwal, Dr. R.D. Kharadkar, Mr. Nagendra Singh to accompany them. Vande Dutishar Hal Dhavala Ya Shubhravastamrita Ya Veena Vardanda Mandit Kara Ya Shweta Padmasana Ya Brahmanchita Shankara Prabhudivi Devai Sada Vandita Saman Pratu Saraswati Bhagavati Nishesh Zadyapaha. Thank you, honorable guest. Now, I request our guest to grace the dais by occupying the seat. I request Mr. Nagendra Singh, Dr. K.K. Paliwal, and Dr. R.D. Kharadkar to escort the guest to the dais and also accompany them on dais. I also request Dr. Preeti Bajaj and Mr. Aditya Bhandari to occupy the seat on dais. Thank you. We have with us today Dr. R.K. Shigavkar, former director IIT Delhi and former vice chancellor SPPU, a strong academician and researcher who not only believe in innovation but also in its implementation. We are obliged to have with us Mr. Dinanath Kolkar, vice president and global head of analytics and insight TCS. We are pleased to have with us the backbone of RGI campus, who always offer his hand of support to us and motivate us with his motivational words, Mr. Ajit Chitatia, Trustee Director, RGI Pune Campus. I request Mr. Ajit Chitatia to offer floral welcome to Dr. Shigavkar and Mr. Dinanath Kolkar. Thank you, sir. I would specially like to mention in his absence about the man behind this event, who not only conceptualized but has also planned and ensured execution, Mr. Shreyas Rai Soni, young and dynamic executive director of RGI. We are also having with us Dr. Preeti Bajaj, director GHRCE, Mr. Aditya Bhandari, Executive Director, RGI from Global Education, Dr. K.K. Paliwal, Director, GHR-CEM, Dr. R.D. Kharadkar, Principal, GHR-IT, and Mr. Nagendra Singh, CEO and Director of RGI Career Foundation, on the dais. A heartfelt gratitude towards you all for your auspicious presence. Before we proceed, may I now request Sri Ajit Tatia, Trustee Director, RGI Pune Campus, to preside over the function. Thank you, sir. It's a privilege to have you with us. I extend my warm welcome to all of you. May I now request Dr. Preeti Bajaj, the Director of GHRCE, to please come forward for preamble, who is working right from the strategy till today for this event, and who is also our mentor director.
Thank you, Kaushal. Chief guest of today's program and former director IIT Delhi, who is also member board of governors of GHRCEM Pune, Professor Shigavkar. Guest of honor and keynote speaker of this GHR Connect program, and my good colleague in IEEE, Mr. Dinanath Kolkar. Executive, our Honorable Chairman, Shri Sunilji Rai Soni, in his absence, Shri Ajitji Tatia, Trustee Director of Pune Campus, all esteemed industry associates, other dignitaries on and off the dais, very good morning. And thank you so much for sparing your precious time, that too on Saturday, for GHR Connect, the first of its kind of program in Pune. I was just wondering whether we can have this program and start in time, and we'll have number of industry associates, everybody on Saturday morning. But then thank you all for believing in us that this program would be really fruitful for both the ends, academia and industry. GHR Connect, if you can see the logo, so GHR Connect, it has Rai Soni Group within it. GHR includes GH Rai Soni. It also includes HR. It also includes Connect, means reaching out to industries. Awards and internships. So for this, industry is being buzzword nowadays. Every student, every academia, we are talking about industry internships. AICT, All India Council of Technical Education, they have introduced 4 mandatory internships for every engineering graduate, every diploma holder, every professional course, about 300 or 400 hours of program within 4 years of engineering. Are our industry, does our industry, I mean associates, knows about this mandatory internships which have been launched by MHRD as a mandatory? Without that, any engineering graduate will not be given degree. There are credit points. There are many questions. How will implement at academia? What are the skill set required? How will be selecting these interns? Will it be another kind of placement? What about if student doesn't take it in a right way? What about the family doesn't support? What about if he does not get an internship in the same town? What about the cost which will be over for internships as well? So many questions. In flagship institute of Raisoni, in 2010, we introduced this 6 months internship in our curricula. So first batch with 6 months internship has been graduated in 2014. Couple of industry associates who are sitting over here, they have really helped us. And believe me, as on today, 1300 plus industry students are taking internships in more than 300 industries. That's the response we received from all of you, many of you. To acknowledge their association, many industries have come forward to establish their labs in many Raisoni campuses. You all are performing best in your domain. To recognize your efforts, to recognize your association with us, we launch some awards this time. Again, these awards have been finalized by our board members of Raisoni, but definitely will improve upon next year by asking nominations as well in various categories. This was about why this program has been organized as on today. Just for your information, as per AICT, today 4,307 diploma institutions are there in the country. Postgraduate, 5,272 institutions are there. Undergrad, 4,426 institutions are there. And total intake for these undergraduate institutions are 15,16,281 to be very precise. This is just intake. Are we ready for that? Does industries have any space for these interns every year? 15 lakh. If I talk about amongst these institutions, 700 plus institutions are there in Maharashtra itself for engineering plus diploma together. Are we ready for this western region? So it includes some part of MP as well. With these statistics, so if I come with the statistics, this Maharashtra diploma 756, undergrad courses 695, professional courses PG 632, and total 1,57,421. This is as per All India Council Technical Education AICT APH handbook 2019 and 20's handbook, which is released in this January based on the statistics which are with MHRD. Graduating every year 82,175 diploma, 1,65,832 undergrad, and 1,578 postgraduate. Deemed universities are 7,528 in the country. Look at the volume which we are supposed to deal. Neither you, so maybe your associates or other part of industry associates. Several versions have been said by many agencies. The youth or the engineers are not employable, quote unquote. But then, if we all have responsibility to make them employable, what would be the role of industries? What would be the role of academia? What would be the capsule? Can it be done by third party like NASSCOM, CII, FICCI? Are they ready to provide these internships? Is there any portal which is required with so much of number? One institution offering, two institution, that's fine. Here we are talking about thousands and lakhs of students. So is there any portal which is required wherein the takers and seekers, everybody can be there, those who are offering internship? There are some portals as well. But those are 1, 2, 10. You can count in fingers how many. Just for the information, sir, I developed one portal. Right now that's not functional, but for Region 10, Asia Pacific, we developed such portal for 2 years back in 2016 under IEEE. It worked well in 3 countries, Pakistan, India, Australia, 3 countries other than India, Australia, Pakistan and Malaysia. But such portal, can we think of, you know, in India as well, which can work? So many questions. And just again, one last point which I wanted to share with all of you. National Board of Accreditation, they have defined 12 graduate outcomes. It means every engineer, before he graduates, there has to be an attainment for 12 program outcomes, which are based on graduates' outcome worldwide. Those are either 11 or 12. Washington Accord, which is based on, you know, you all must be knowing the engineering accord system in US, which is ABET. So ABET follows 11 graduate outcomes. India follows 12 graduate outcomes. Believe me, out of 12 graduate outcomes, only 3 or 4 you can think of in classroom or maybe within 4 walls of your engineering institution. All rest of the outcomes you cannot attain until unless student undergoes in internship or he is spending quite some time in the industry. Looking at all these scenario, we have arranged this program GHR Connect. We have kept a copy of industry internship in your folders. You can go through it whenever you will be getting time. And it would show you the AICT is expecting second semester student to undertake 4 weeks internship. Every year during summer break, student must go for internship. 4 years, 300 hours, and they have come out with credits, 12 to 16 credits you must assign. The student must do some project which is based on industrial problem. So today's program has keynotes. So Mr. Dinanath is going to address on Industry 4.0. Mr. Hari from L&T Realty, he is going to have on projects and internship in the second half. Then we have 3 panel discussion on the skill set required, interpersonal skills required before taking up internships, the technical skills required before taking internship. Then are we ready and what is being expected out of internship? Do we require any boot camp before students take up any internship? Right now we are giving one day boot camp. So the today's program has keynotes, panel discussion and then question answer. So with this, once again, on behalf of Raisoni Group of Institutions, and my behalf of, I welcome you all to this GHR Connect to be held in Pune. And before I sign off, I would request all of you, we have a very good gathering. So can we have short introduction of each other? 3 points only, your name, your organization and your role. That would help us to understand who all are here. So, sorry, I'm just changing the sequence, but just short introduction will help us to know how is, you know, the energy in this, vibrancy in this hall. So, Amita and
Scientist Dave from one of DRDO laboratory at Pune, Vishranwadi, R&D engineers. And I myself is working in the field of unmanned system and robotics and delivering products for Indian Army. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. We can pass on to next.
Good morning. I am Manikandan. I work for Fiat. I essentially take care of supplier quality function. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Sanjay Dureja. I've come from Tata Motors. I'm working in the area of digital technology for engineering.
Good morning. I'm Bilavari Karkare. I'm the director of Vishwakarma Institute of Information Technology, and our college is Autonomous College.
Yeah, hi, good morning, everyone. My name is Sankit Thodge. I'm coming on behalf of IR Square Digital Solutions Private Limited. So we're into big data, blockchain, and IoT. And I'm the founder and director of the same company. Thank you very much.
Good morning, everyone. I am Kushal Sharma. We have a startup called as Prushal Technology Private Limited. I also run one training company, which is known as Indeed Inspiring. Our software, the Prushal Tech actually works on software development, and I am an alumni of GHRCAM. Thank you.
Good morning, all. My name is Tulshiram Udholkar. I am a passionate trainer and currently working with Wipro as project manager. Thank you.
Good morning. Myself Prasad Bhujang. I work with Technofor as a senior mechanical engineer. Our company is into manufacturing of eddy current based non-destructive testing equipments.
Yeah, good morning, all. This is Yogesh Bhaviskar. I came from Cognizant. I'm working as a manager in Cognizant, and I also came here in this basically program just to check what exactly the happenings over here, because I'm continuously being the part of the campus recruitment from our company, and I have been moving all around in India also. So I've been observing too many suggestions and things from all of the colleges, all that. So I just came here to check what exactly things are happening and how the institutions are planning for their next future. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Hello. Good morning, all. Myself, Kanchan Bharadwaj. I'm representing Global Step Services. I'm handling HR operations in Global Step, and I'm an alumni of Raisoni.
Hello, my name is Ravi Mahajan. I have a 22-year experience in power and development. I am an independent consultant for the organizations, how to basically motivate and ignite minds. And I am working on a project of creating a platform for academy, industry, and the individuals, where all of the three can prosper.
Yeah, Dharmin. Yes, sir.
All right. Hi, good morning, everyone. My name is Majid. I am from Mphasis. I'm responsible for talent acquisition for Mphasis, cutting across multiple verticals, and manage a business which has got a portfolio of about $300 million. Thank you.
No. Good morning to all. Myself, Jivraj Chole. I'm representing Uchit Media Services. Basically, it is a media consultancy and PR agency, and I'm the owner of company. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is C.G. Kulkarni. I'm Managing Director of Bell Engineering Software Technology Limited. We are in the field of providing engineering consultancy to oil and gas, onshore as well as offshore. And we provide these services internationally. But we started, I came back to India and set up this company here. So, and then in many other countries, but I'm Indian and a proud Indian.
Thank you, sir.
Good morning. I'm Arun Adivarekar from Kirloskar Pneumatics Company Limited, Pune. I'm Associate Vice President and Head of Quality. My responsibility is quality assurance for the entire group of Kirloskar Pneumatic Company and employee involvement with various new initiatives. Thank you.
Welcome, sir.
Hello, good morning. I am Mahesh Ambi. I came from Kirloskar Oil Engines, Pune. I'm responsible there for manufacturing, engineering, and project activities.
Yeah, very good morning to everyone. Myself, Prashant Kulkarni, I'm from Thermax. I look after head of sourcing of Thermax, where we source different vendors and different materials. I am also in charge of IT infrastructure of Thermax and as well as subcontracting of Thermax. Thank you.
Good morning. I am Mani Vasagam, better known as Mani, from Tata Technologies. I am Global Head of Vehicle Engineering.
Welcome, sir.
Good morning, all. This is Yugesh. Yugesh Deshpande from LTI, L&T Infotech, part of the L&T group. I'm responsible for delivery and operations for big data analytics platforms and solutions at LTI.
Good morning. I'm Dr. Munir Sayed. I'm Vice President of Reliance Jio and Head of the Innovation Labs. And I'm responsible for productizing new next generation technologies and taking the new technologies to the first POC and then productionizing it. Thank you.
Hi, good morning. I'm Sachin Kshesagar, representing Tekish Engineering India Private Limited. I'm a general manager of operations of this sheet metal fabrication division, and our company is involved into the various activity like HVAC systems, automotive paint shops, railway paint shops, and different verticals. Thank you.
Good morning, all. I'm Prashant Malamkar. I'm working as a general manager with LG Electronics, the major in consumer electronics and home appliances. I'm heading supply chain functions and the international business. Apart from this, I'm also a certified trainer. I'm taking the trainings of the functional and the capability enhancement of the employees. Thank you.
Yeah, good morning, everyone. This is Alvin D'Souza from SR Steel, Sanaswadi. I'm the head of electrical and automation over there. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Raghu Nair. I represent Forbes Marshall Pune. And I am in charge of the corporate training activities of Forbes Marshall.
Welcome, sir.
Yeah, good morning, everyone. I am Rohit Munwat. I am here from Harnik Systems Private Limited. I am the director of Harnik Systems. So we are into manufacturing of wiring harnesses. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Emmanuel Vergis. I'm here from Triplan India. I'm working as the principal engineer, instrumentation and control. We are primarily an engineering, procurement and construction company for the chemical and petrochemical sector.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Jagdish Chaudhary. I lead special initiatives in the analytics and insights unit of TCS. I'm also an active member of IEEE Pune section.
Hello, good morning. I am Dhanraj Kolle from Bharat Electronics Limited, Manorathna Company. I am responsible for development and engineering of new projects for the military, defense forces. Thank you.
Okay, good morning, everybody. My name is Prashant Wani. I am coming from a company called Cummins. We are manufacturing diesel engines, gensets, and supplying engines to various worldwide applications and then different OEMs. Presently, my role is leading the engineering organization for fuel system. And then one of the most challenging projects right now, which many of us are working for completing BS6, Bharat Stage 6 emissions, which is coming up. And I'm really looking forward to have a good interactions today and trying to contribute for making this really valuable session. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Sanjay Nibande, representing Automotive Research Association of India. I take care of operations at Chakan. We have second labs over there. Also, I represent for SAE Western section as a chairman. And we handle the knowledge dissemination in engineering areas where the faculties, engineering professionals, and students are involved. So we conduct so many events for the students, and SAE is becoming quite popular. Now almost like 22 years in India, more than 22 years in India in SAE representation, conducts a lot of seminars and conducts a lot of knowledge dissemination sessions. Thank you.
Hello, very good morning to everyone here. I am Rajendra Khope, founder and CEO IOCare Pune. We deal in the field of IoT embedded solutions, home automation and industrial automation. We have started from like 7 years back in the field of IoT. We are also working in the field of smart city development, various sensors and solutions development for the smart city. Thank you very much.
Good morning. I am Bhushan Patil, working as a senior data scientist with Philips Healthcare Innovation Center. and currently I'm working on deep learning and AI applications for healthcare. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Rahul Chute, Director Delivery at CTR Technology Solutions. Not to confuse with the other CTR, we are small size IT consulting. We are into Oracle ERP implementations. Thank you.
Good morning, all. This is Umesh Ganjale from Tech Mahindra Limited. So I'm Global Head, Fresher, Hiring, okay, and Training. Thank you.
Good morning, dignitaries and all my colleagues over here for this program. I'm Dr. Rachna Shikre. After 18 years of academic career, I have now joined two organizations as a mentor and chief skilling evangelist. So these companies are basically going to cater the skilling requirements for the students specifically, making them industry 4.0 ready, talking about various subjects like not only managerial subjects, but soft skills, as well as technical subjects like business analytics and AI specifically. And we are also catering towards individual training online and offline, as well as corporate trainings as well. Thank you so much.
Good morning, I'm Amol Mahulikar. I'm from Regal Beloit Corporation. I'm Senior Product Manager for Marketing. I take care of global marketing strategy for our business.
Good morning, all. Myself, Nishikant Chaudhary, working for the company called ITT Corporation. I am responsible for the All India business for automotive, defense, and railway business segment. Thank you.
Hi, I am Kaushik Banerjee from Red Hat India. I manage the security teams here in Red Hat, and my teams are basically responsible for developing automation tests for all the security products that is there in Red Hat. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. I'm Pradyumna Roy. I'm representing a company by name IDEMIA. We have software platforms in the field of digital payments and eSIM-based connectivity. I head the software development for the company in Pune. Thank you.
Hello, good morning, all. My name is Vinod Gadkar. I'm from FL Smith, Pune. I'm working as a manager there. We are in mining and cement industry. So we deal with analysis and design of mobile machines and IPC. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Vivek Pashine. I am from Tieto India Private Limited. So we are the leading company of IT service providing in Nordic area. So we are dealing with all the product that is needed for ITSM, and that includes automation, monitoring, and different kind of tools that support the day-to-day operation of the different teams. So thanks.
Good morning, everyone. I am Ajay Dhalpawar, heading to technical training for Netafim India. Netafim is an irrigation company, and I'm the responsible for technical trainings in the Netafim. Thank you.
Hello, my name is D.A. Darekar. At present, I'm director for the Synergy Tech Solutions, the company. But prior to that one, I would like to tell my previous experience. I started my career in 1986 as a CAD/CAM support engineer. After that one, I worked on many big automotive industry in the CAD/CAM, in R&D division, D division, and mostly international projects like Mercedes-Benz and these companies also. And I was heading one of the division, that is engineering services and training. And meanwhile, I worked for the many educational institutes as a technical advisor in Pune and around even overall Maharashtra. At present, I'm working for the Canada-based projects and US-based projects, aerospace and this one. Thank you.
Good morning, all. I am Parth Amal Gaukar. I am working with Symantec.
My company is primarily one of the leaders into security, cyber security more so. I work in the development on the endpoint encryption side of Symantec. I'm also an alumni from GHR Sony, and I'm happy to be here among all the stellars in this hall. Thank you so much.
Good morning, all. I am Ankit Kalantri. I am also an alumni of GHR Group, and I'm currently working with GS Lab. I take care of projects involving backend services and cloud services. We're currently involved in making a unique mobile app that generates scores out of physical and mental illness for humans from humans' voice, vocal biomarkers. We're working collaboratively with scientists from MIT Lincoln Labs and some other institutions, and we'll be launching this product in India soon. Thank you.
Good morning, this is Dilip Singh. I am the founder and CEO of Innovators Technologies Pune. We are having experience and expertise in customized software development since 20 years. And we are providing the trainings for the students of the graduates and undergraduates and postgraduates in machine learning and cloud computing.
Hi, good morning all. My name is Gaurav Zavar. I'm from Medrio. As a product manager, I take care of clinical trial product management and new development. Thank you.
Hello, good morning everybody. My name is Srihari Notla. I am working in a company, MNC company, that is Trantor India Private Limited. Trantor is manufacturing plate type heat exchangers, and this is globally it's in a top position for 1 to 3 positions. And I am working as a divisional manager R&D. I have been working for past 12 years in this company, and the company is located in Pune only. I am doing a lot of testing for the plate type heat exchangers, and we will evaluate the correlations for the heat exchangers, which are useful for the designing the software for the plate type heat exchangers. So the salespeople can easily select the heat exchangers based on the software development, whatever we have developed. Thank you.
Hello.
I'm Kapil Chuk from Sakshi Constructions. I'm a civil engineer by profession, and we have been successfully delivering projects of commercial, residential, as well as military projects across Pune, and we endeavor to have the best of construction practices and ethics in the industry. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. Myself Radhakrishna Nemani, working with Brose Automotive Systems, which is a German-based Tier 1 OEM. I am responsible for all the FEA activities happening in a seat department in Pune. Thank you.
Hello everyone, I am Shashikant. We are the manufacturer of fin and tube type evaporator that is a pioneer in India. I am planted for that company. It is situated in Supa. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Gajanan Manjaramkar. I am associate director Flag Group India Private Limited. This is multinational company making various HVAC products. I am heading Precision Air Conditioner Division, looking after sales and R&D in the capacity of associate director. We have our manufacturing facility in Greater Noida, Uttar Pradesh, and a sales and service office in Pune, and we are operating from Pune. Thank you.
So this will be the last, and then we'll start with the program. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Good morning, everybody. Myself, Mr. G.R. Thakur, representing Accurate Group of Companies, the pioneer and the oldest manufacturing company for metrology and quality control. Everyone might be knowing all these things, but we are here and thinking grateful to attend this Connect program so that we are here to minimize the bridge between the academic and the industries, as today, industry is very much trying to get an ready engineer, and we try our level best to make the engineer to work him through, as we are working with all training sessions, and we have already provided in Maharashtra more than 300 plus engineering colleges our metrology and quality control lab. As Risoni Group is a very close associate with Accurate Groups, hoping for having a good connection with them. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. And we'll be again having the rest of the people who have joined us late. We'll have introduction round. But to start with the program, look at the vibrancy. so many core companies, IT sector, our own alumni, they are here, and then all academicians. So really, we are overwhelmed to see your response, and I'm sure a lot of takeaway would be there from this program. We also welcome Professor Veer Singh, who is UGC nominee on our board of governors, and who is here for today's meeting. Thank you, sir, for being here. I'll request all of you, like if you can, you have a notepad, so please look at the program. Three sessions are there. Whatever question you feel like asking to the panel, if you can keep those questions ready, that would save our time, because so much of content within 6 hours of the day. So with this, once again, welcome to all of you on behalf of Prize-Winning Group of Institutions, and enjoy. And do network. I'm sure you will. We all will be connecting soon after this program. And this is not the last. This is just beginning. Thank you.
For the wonderful insight. Today we are having with us Dr. Raghunath K. Shigavkar. Sir is eminent academician who has been in the forefront of leading excellence in higher technical education in India. An alumnus of Indian Institute of Technology at Kanpur and Mumbai, Dr. Shigavkar was previously Vice Chancellor of University of Pune and Director of IIT Delhi. He played a key role in commissioning one of the world's largest decameter wave telescopes at Indian Institutes of Astrophysics and Ramana Research Institute, Bangalore, established research center for optical communication, and founded Center for Distance Engineering Education at IIT Bombay. Dr. Raghunathan has served as Deputy Director of Finance and External Affairs, Dean of Student Affairs, Dean of Mobilization, and Head of Electrical Engineering Department at IIT Bombay. Dr. Raghunath has been the recipient of IEEE Undergraduate Teaching Award 2011, IETECO ET 94 Award, Top Management Consultant Award 2010, Devang Mehta Business School Award 2010, Education Leadership Award 2012 from Headlines Today, Vaswik Award 2009, IET Ramlal Vadra Award 2013, and IEEE William E. Self Award 2014 for Achievements in Education. I request him to please come forward for inaugural address.
All the distinguished dignitaries on the dais, of the dais, distinguished participants to this program, distinguished leaders from the industry, the staff and faculty of the Raisoni College of Engineering, a very good morning to you. This is a great privilege to talk to so many industry people, and the issues which we have been talking for many years. Once again, we are here to discuss the issue, which is the industry-academia partnership or relationship. At the outset, I would like to congratulate the Raisoni Group for organizing this program, the Raisoni Connect program with the industry. And this is a great initiative. And I was asking Dr. Bajaj, is the first time we are holding it? She said, no, we held this program in Nagpur. I think in Pune area, we are holding it first time. So it's a great occasion to really get so many industry people together and sitting with academia and going to talk about how to connect with each other. Though the focus is going to be more on the internship, that's what probably we are going to have a more panel discussion and issues related to that, I will probably dwell in more detail of how we can develop the relationship with the industry with the academic institution. That's what probably I'm going to do in this introductory talk. Now, AICT, as has been mentioned earlier, AICT now has made this internship mandatory in our engineering program. I remember when I was a student, this internship was not mandatory. In fact, this internship word also was not there. The word was actually a educational tour or educational visits, and a group of students which was not mandatory necessary, some group who could afford it, they could come together, they could go to other city like Bangalore, could see the research laboratories like Bell, Bharat Electronics, or BHEL, and got some exposure from the industry. But most of the activities which happen, actually they happen only either in the college or nearby institutions. Now the MHRD and AICTE has said that this internship is a mandatory requirement. So that first, initially one can ask some few questions about this nature of this mandatoriness. What is the purpose of this, making this the internship mandatory? And this question you have to ask from two sides. You have to ask this question from the academia side. We have to also ask this question from the industry side. Right? And that, then we can see how we can sort of converge on what we are expecting from this. So if you see from academia side, the academia expect that this will give the students an exposure of the industrial environment. Like whatever we can tell them in the college, maybe it's not enough. You know, they have to go on the shop floors and really see what is happening in the industry. They can also see, if they go to industry, the students, the application of the concepts which the academia has covered in the classrooms. And many times, the real life situations are not really discussed in the classroom. In fact, the classroom problems are always a very idealistic problems, you know, for which most of the time the solutions are known. However, when you go to industry, the problems are never idealistic, first. Secondly, the solutions are most of the time non-existent. You have to really find the solutions. So the exposure to that environment, that everything is not readily available and always solvable immediately, I think that is a very good learning which the students would get if they go to the industry. That's what academia expects. On the other side, if you go to the industry, what are the industry expects when somebody intern comes to the industry? So they will be expecting some contribution of the interns when they come to the industry. If somebody just comes and whiles away, spends some time of few weeks and doesn't contribute to the industry, probably industry may not be very much interested really getting the interns into the industry program. Second thing, industry feels that if this internship is done, would the student become industry ready when they graduate from the institutions? Can they be directly employable? That's the second expectation industry would expect. Third, the expectation could be that this student come from the intern, can there be potential hires in future? So if you can find really good students, you know, the intern, maybe the industry can go ahead and offer them jobs after a few months after they graduate. That's what the industry expects. However, while having said this, both parties expect these kind of things, there are certain challenges which are there in implementing this internship program. Firstly, as the numbers which Dr. Bajaj said, I think these numbers are really mind-boggling. If you have to really place every year about 15 lakh students into the industry as an intern, I think this is really a greatest challenge. Because if the industry expects something in return when somebody is coming, you know, for as an intern, then placing these 15 lakh students is really going to be a biggest challenge, you know, because many of the industries, do they have that kind of requirement? Secondly, this industry also feels that 6 to 8 weeks of internship is not a very productive internship. And I have been discussing with industry people for many, many years. And predominantly, these concepts comes by the time the students even understand what is going on around them in the industry, their internship time is over, and they have to go back. So it is practically a waste of time on spending of these people who just come and spend there about 6 to 8 weeks, and there's no contribution which is made there. How can we make it more productive there? Can the internship be paid or non-paid? If the internship is non-paid, can the student go into another city? Then if we go to another city, where will he live? How will he survive? These are some of the questions which the students also ask, and industry also has to grapple with this. You know, that how they can make it, you know, more attractive for the students. You know, and the internship should become more and more attractive. The solution, on and off, keep coming, is that make the internship that is for the longer time. So many times the industry made a proposal that don't say the internship is only for 6 to 8 weeks. Can we merge this internship along with the project, which could be for one semester down the line? Then the students may come there for about 5 to 6 months. And maybe that is a good time to really contribute something to the industry, some of the suggestions which were made there. So combining the project with the internship, that could be one of the possibilities where the industry also sees some value addition in really supporting this the internship program. So these are some of the issues which we have been talking about. And now the MHRD also said, AICT also said, there has to be, after first year, there has to be internship. Some of the institutions, they call it a social internship. The student should really go and understand the society, how the society is going to be around them so that they can apply technology for solving societal problems. All these things looks very nice on paper. But when AICT, even I was there on the committees for many times on the discussion, the most of the time the issues came is, yes, on paper we can put something. When it comes to implementation, have we really thought about it? And whenever this discussion takes place for the internship in AICT bodies also, there is hardly any representation from the industry. Most of the time the representation is only from the academia side. So again, only one side is sort of projected properly, but the requirement how we are going to meet in practice, right, these issues were never really addressed there. So this is some of the issues which are related to the internship, if you have to really make it very, very successful. And in near future, we don't expect a very, very easy solution also to this, right? So if the productivity is not there, if there is no great accountability, there are no returns on the internship, the industry will always remain apprehensive. And I'm not blaming the industry for that. I think they'll be very well justified in saying that, if I really waste time on this, what am I going to get in return? So internship and employment of the students into the industry, this in my opinion is just one aspect of the industry academia partnership. Right? And we are going to focus that on that in today in the seminar. But I think if you really go and ask, is that the only purpose of industry and academia to really come together? Just for sending the student for internship and just placing them later on in long term? Is that enough? And you will see that no, as India is saying that we want to become sometime the global power, right? We want to make in India product, we want to create the IP from India. This linkage between academia and industry is not enough. We have to do far more than this to really make India as a economic and intellectual powerhouse. And that's what we have to talk about, that when we talk about this situation, we have to ask that can we make this partnership, which is much more than just the placing the student into the industry, and a customer kind of relationship. We have to build something more than that, not only customer kind of relationship. So let us imagine today the way, if you want to really create the intellectual IP in our industry so that we can become globally competitive, one of the things which is very, very important is that the industry-oriented research, which can be patentable, which will generate the IP, that has to be focus of this industry-academia partnership. Industry is quite busy in the production, meeting their targets, and they may not have enough time to really do the IP generation. They can get the IP, maybe implement it, develop a product, make marketing, and so on and so on. Who will generate the IP? And probably in most of the Western world, if you really go and see, this IP generation actually is done by academia. It is not primarily done by industry. The industry takes the support of academia to create the IP. They get the IP and they convert the IP into monetization, so convert into products, and then this product actually go into the market. So industry-academia relationship, when we are talking about, it should be a partnership for IP generation. That is one of the prime focuses which industry-academia partnership should be talking about. So academia should actually become a backbone for carrying out a frontline research which industry can monetize. I think that partnership essentially is a much longer sustainable partnership. Question again would come is that if this kind of partnership is created and you have to do some research which can be converted into money later on by the industry, where is the funding going to come from? Today, when we are talking about even government infrastructure, we talk about the CSR money, corporate social responsibility. And most of the time, this money goes into building toilets, right, or many other things, you know, which are really, of the bottom of the society. That's where actually CSR money is targeted to. In my opinion, today in our country, the highest priority should be for the quality education development, which can really create the quality research. Can the industry convince government and academia together that we can have put substantial portion of the CSR money into converting this partnership and create the research which later on can be converted into IP and which will go into the national development? So that is something which is there. This model is, I'm not proposing this model something just from my side. This model has been a very, very successful model in the United States. This model is the backbone of Israel industry, right? All the universities in Israel actually work very, very strongly linked with the academia, and they have this innovation which are coming from academia and which they convert into this. So they put the money. So do we require this kind of model if you want to work on, then we have to really develop this partnership to create the IP, right, which is going to come from the academia. That, in my opinion, is one of the requirements to really come the industry and academia together, in addition to, you know, hiring of the people, which is, of course, which will go on. So today, if you really ask, if you go to academia, even for the research institutions in India, premier research institution, even if you take them, like IITs and NITs and many others, you one can ask a question, how many of these people are really doing a research which is industry-oriented? So just take few numbers, you know. In India, our gross enrollment ratio is about 20%. That's what the number which is quoted everywhere, right? Out of this 20% gross enrollment, right, 5% of these people actually go to engineering education, right, out of total graduate which we produce. Out of that 5% people, actually very small fraction actually do research. 1% of that who do research are actually doing the research which is relevant to the industry. So if you put all together, you will see we are having almost 1 in 1 lakh graduates who actually do the applied industrial research. That is the reality. Shouldn't we do this much stronger than that, much better than this, so that our application-based, research-based stronger and we can contribute more to industry? I think that's where the need for this partnership is. So if you decide together, then we can really create a model. And we have to really work on this. Because we have seen organically, would this joint venture will work? We have seen in the last 20 years, it has not worked. We have to really set targets, both sides, industry as well as academia, and say that no, we are determined to work together to really get this partnership going. That's for something which is required here. So the first thing which is required is here, that create an environment which will force industry and academia to come together. And one of the things which I am saying is CSR. CSR is something which is mandatory now. If the industry put this CSR money into creating this IP, and if government really allows that, right, this will be a great motivation for the industry to really come forward and put this money into education and get the research done, which can eventually go to the society. Secondly, we require is create a system which will mentor unconventional thinking and will provide thinking space. This is something which we require in academia. Today in academia, we are having an extremely straight-jacketed curricula. And just before the program, we are talking to Mr. Dinanath Kholkar, that technology is changing very, very rapidly, right? New technology is going to come there. Is our academic flexible enough to really accommodate these changes? So 2 years back when AICT made these changes in the model curriculum, I happened to be the chairman of this electronics and communication curriculum. What we did first thing is, we reduced the core of the curriculum to almost 30 to 40%. And we said 50% of the curriculum should be flexible. And this flexibility can be incorporated not even at the university level, you can incorporate this flexibility even at the college level. So you can offer the elective courses which you say students have to take 10 elective courses. Which elective courses they will take, leave it to the people, leave it to the students. So they may decide if the industry can really collaborate, they can really sort of gear and make the program which can be more suitable for the immediate requirement which is coming from the industry. Create a program which will actually develop the technologist who will be working on the contemporary problem. And this flexibility actually with the industry, they can really come together and do that. Master's program, PhD program which come from the industry, if they can make, which are industry oriented, then this program can really contribute to the development of the industrial requirement. So industry and academia both should, first of all, appreciate the strength of each other. That is something very, very important. Whenever we have had a seminar, I mean, I was in Pune University and we had this kind of seminars earlier also, the seminar invariably ends in pointing out what the other side doesn't have. Right? What we should ask is, the other side has something which is complementary to you. And you will see there are many things which are complementary, right? Something which the industry has, the academia doesn't have. Something which the academia has, the industry doesn't have. Once you understand this complementary nature of each other, then there is a great possibility of working together because we complement each other. So first important thing is we have to first understand that we appreciate each other's strengths and not point out each other's weaknesses. The weaknesses are there on both the sides and the strengths have to be leveraged upon. So what we need is actually we require an industry-academia partnership. Okay? Now also, many times when the industry comes forward and interacts with the academia, the projects are given, right? And CSR money also, even if it comes there, most of the time it will happen is, it will be like a return of money. Industry, when the projects are also given to academia, invariably, the industry perspective is, okay, I have done my job. If there's something comes from that, I will use it. If it doesn't come, I'm okay with that. I'm happy that I have done some job given to something academia. No, we are not looking for that. That is not going to work. We are looking for something which is a partnership. That means if the project is given by the industry, the academia and industry people should work together on that project. And if the project fails, both understand why the project failed. If the project succeeds, both get the credit for it and really monetize it and share the benefit which is going to come from the project. So this subcontracting something or giving an assignment to the academia by the industry and is something which is not going to work productively. We have to develop a relationship which is a partnership relationship. And this was something which we tried to do when I was in Pune University. It was the experiment which we did. You know, and that experiment was quite successful, right? Very, very much in this city. So when I was vice chancellor, the first thing which I was worried about is that how do I get the industrial research into Pune University? And the first thing which I did is I just went and made a presentation to the Maratha Chamber of Commerce. And I said, look, can Pune University do something for industry who are the affiliates of the Maratha Chamber of Commerce? What was the model? The model was the academia should facilitate the research, right, which is required by the industry, but carried out in university. So one of the model was, can you hire somebody and jointly with university with an understanding that if you hire him, I will give him admission for my postgraduate program. The research which he's going to do for your research. But once he does the research and whatever report he writes, I can treat that as my M.Tech thesis. So in that time, he got his master's degree or PhD degree. The industrial work was done because it was sponsored by the industry, right? And so at the end of 2 years, 4 years, if you find that the person who was there, who was really excellent, you continue him with your service. If he is not worth it, at least you ask him, thank you very much, but he got his degree, at least enhanced degree he got. So this was a situation which was good for both, for industry and academia. And believe me, in Pune University, many of the top technology officers from the industry were sitting with me in interviewing candidates to join this program. We interviewed about 2,000 candidates. Even Kirloskar was probably one of the people who were there. And out of these 2,000 people, we selected about almost 30 people. But these 30 people whom we selected, the industry said, yes, they are great. We want to hire them. And university said, yes, we will give them admission. Most of the time what happened, this step was earlier, it was a two-step process. Somebody is working industry, he comes for academia half the time rejects him. He is not up to the mark. Somebody is in the academia, he goes to industry says, no, he is not up to the mark. If we jointly select him, the both will own the responsibility. And that created this technology center, which was in Pune University, right? So this is one of the models which we tried and worked in the Pune University. And this kind of activity, if you really do, then the bright people can be attracted towards industry who have a potential to really create IP and create a research which can be really converted into the industrial product. So basically, this kind of interaction which we talked about, right, the research which we wanted to bring, which should be industry oriented, and we call this program is the graduate program or the postgraduate program for industry by industry. So anything which we has to be done with the focus which is going to come from the industrial orientation. So that is something which we require, you know. And in this process, the financial things are automatically taken care of. Understand this. Because whenever somebody comes and says, I want to get a sponsored project, you are sponsoring a project. That means industry feels there's money I am giving to somebody. In this program, what will happen is you are hiring a person which you even otherwise would have hired for your requirement. So you are paying him salary. Nothing extra is required. And in that process, he is getting his degree, also getting advanced there. Maybe in your own organization, you will have a person who will be better qualified to do research later on in your own organization. Right? So this model seemed to be very, very attractive to the Pune industry. And a lot of people really came together and really activated this property there. While doing this, the biggest challenge which came is, and we can always sort of discuss on that, is that when some IP is generated in this process, who will own the IP? The person who is working on academia, he feels, look, I put my intellectual thing, so shouldn't I be owning my IP? The industry felt, we are putting money into this, so why shouldn't I be owning the IP? We require a very, very robust model of sharing IP, which is actually done in the Western industry, where Western universities and industry. The IP, there are clear norms which are defined, that when the IP is monetized, so some fraction of that will go to academia, some person will go to individuals, some person will go to industry, and so on and so on. We can also create a model that will be first right to refusal by the industry. So if the research is done for that particular industry, the industry can always buy that IP which is generated for this program there. Now to do this, what is required is that the industry and academia, first of all, should understand the requirement of each other. Okay? So I have some suggestions, you know, which can be implemented in addition to the internship program. Can we have the internship program for the faculty? The faculty for 2 months in summer are free, right? Can the person go and spend time in industry? They need not even pay. Industry need not even pay. If they can pay, very well and good, but they don't have to because the salary comes from the organizations anyway. So instead of really saying that I am on 2 months vacation, if the person goes and sits into the industry, he will get exposed to the industrial problems. Once he gets exposed to the industrial problem, next time when he teaches the same course, he will bring back that knowledge to the classroom. Once that knowledge comes to the classroom, the students will get excited by the industry. If the students get excited by the industry, they will look for an opportunity to work in that particular industry. That is one way of getting connected with the industry from academia side. The same thing we can expect from the industry also for the academia. And what am I proposing? The biggest problem which the industry faces when some graduate goes there is that the student don't have the practical life experience. They don't know real life problems. That's what most of the time the industry faces difficulty with. My suggestion is very simple. In your engineering program, can the industry depute their technology people to take only 10 to 15% of the classes of a particular course? What am I suggesting? I'm suggesting a class, typically when you take a course, the typical course is about 40 lectures. I'm saying 10% of that, right? 4 lectures or maximum 6 lectures. An industry person should come and say, well, you learned control system. Where is the control system applied? Here it is applied. He gives numerous examples which are done in the industry to tell that's where the control system concepts are applied. That's where that's how the system works. These are the limitations of your system. What is taught to you in the class? Yes, a very idealistic situation. Half the time, industry is not like that. Can industry come and tell this to the students? This has two advantages. It has two advantages because when the industry people come and talk to the students there, firstly, the industrial environment, at least in a virtual way, will be brought to the classroom. So students will understand, you know, the industrial problem which are there. Secondly, without even waiting for the internship, the industry will spot the bright school students in the class, right? And they can sort of say, well, can you come and work with me? Even instead of student coming and asking, the people can really look for the students, you know, who are the bright student there. So this way, this flow will be both ways. And in that case, you will see that now people will start appreciating, you know, the good things on both sides. So if industry feels that this is the knowledge which should be imparted to the students, can industry come and offer a course? I think today the curriculum really flexible curriculum which offers there. So I'll tell you an interesting thing. The number which was, I think Dr. Bajaj also said, 20% people are employable in industry, which said NASCOM said everybody went very gaga on that look, quality is bad, students and so on and so on. We went and I was from NPTEL project, which created this NPTEL courses, you know, for the engineering education. We went to NASCOM and we said, tell us what is to be taught to the students, which will make them employable, right? We take your comment that 20% are only employable. You will not believe me. After a lot of deliberation, they came with a course, one course, okay, which is a combination of data structure, programming, and algorithms. And this lecture is how many lectures? This course? 40 lectures. So I said, if this one course is the one which you think is employable, makes the people employable, why don't you offer this course to the high school students, you know? Make them employable. Would they become employable? Certainly they will not become employable. Why not? So what we are underestimating is, we are thinking that this icing, which we are talking about, is the icing is the something which industry requires, which is not true. The icing is good, provided the cake is solid. If the cake is not solid, the icing cannot sustain. So if I take the same course which I can offer to a graduate engineer who has done a foundation course very, very well, that one course will make him employable. But if the foundation was not very solid, that one course will not make him employable. So the academia job is to make the foundation solid. That's what their primary focus should be. And industry job should be to put that icing as appropriately as possible, which will keep on changing as the technology changes ups and down, you know, and nowadays every 5 years technology changes. So industry can really participate in doing that. Industry can also offer, in our opinion, maybe this program, this course is into virtual mode, which can be given to the academia and vice versa. So if this thing is done, if the industry and academia come together and understand that, well, how can we make these people useful to us, right? And what academia should take care before they really graduate. And very small changes if you can make into the curriculum and the interaction between industry. I think we can really create an environment where this, you know, two can really produce a good quality engineers. At the same time, we can do good quality research, which can be application oriented and which can be monetized later. I think this is the model which the industry and academia should really work together. So expectation which are there from the industry and from academia, if I have spelled out some, but I'm sure if we sit across the table, there'll be many more ideas which can come together. And then only thing what is required is, we require a determination that no, we will not walk off from the room without saying that we'll do something together, right? If the choice is not given to anybody, if the choice is not given to anybody, we will always find a solution. If the choice is given, then at the end of the day, you always say, thank you so much, very nice program, and so on and so on. And nothing really comes out of that. So in my opinion, the industry, this partnership, which is industry academia partnership, is actually a win-win partnership. Right? It is not like win-lose partnership. Nobody is going to lose in this process. The both are going to win for that. So a strong industry academia R&D base is developed, which makes the industry globally competitive and self-reliant. I want to quote, I'm in Pune, always tempted to quote Dr. Mashalkar's quote. He always says, the academia converts the money into knowledge, and the industry converts knowledge into money. And this loop has to be complete. If the loop is broken, then knowledge will not be created, and the money also will not be created there. I think if we work together, that is the loop which we have to complete. Academia is exposed to the challenges of industrial research, and students are exposed to the real life problems, right? So both sides will appreciate and understand the problems of each other. Bright students will get attracted to cutting edge research. Retaining talent in core engineering sector, right, which is one of the greatest challenges today. The premier institution, if you take places like IIT, where I spent my life, today the topmost students are not going to engineering. They are going to the financial markets. What are they doing? Time series analysis, nothing more than that. But if there was a great engineering opportunity which was possible to them, wouldn't they come for engineering? Yes, they will. Provided we pose them a really good challenging engineering problem. And that's where it is required from the industry academia. Pose a problem to them for which the solution is not known. Maybe the problem is not even required tomorrow. Maybe the problem is required 10 years down the line. maybe a blue sky problem, but press them to the limit that no, find a solution for this this problem which is not even seen on the horizon, and you will see there are enough bright kids which will be there, who will come forward and really solve the problem there. Retaining, so this talent retaining in the core engineering sectors is something which will be achieved by this. India-centric research will be carried out. And the biggest thing will be the IP will be generated in-house. Today, even our topmost industries, the IP is generated somewhere else. We are only implementing that IP. Even in our IT sector, when we talk about where does the money go? The money goes, they're all, research houses are all set in the United States. They are all the implemented here, but the IP always sits there. I think, can we turn this around and say, well, we work together and we will create IP right here. And when that happens, I think we become powerhouse together, right? And academia and industry both will feel that no, we would not have done that without interacting with each other, without each other's support. I think that's what we should be working for. Internship is one small subset of that. And I would expect that we all will have more deliberation on these lines here. So thank you very much for this opportunity and wish you all the best. Have a great seminar. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for such a marvelous inputs about the actual challenges in industry and academics and the ways of overcoming them. It's a pleasure to invite Mr. Dinanath Kolkar, who is VP and Global Head of Business Process Services and Analytics Units for Tata Consultancy Services. He is responsible for formulating the unit strategy across the global footprint. With over $2 million in revenues and over 300 customers spanning various industries, TCS is recognized as a leader in BPS and artificial intelligence by customers and industry analysts alike. In his previous role, he led the financial services verticals within TCS. May I now request Mr. Dinanath Kolkar to please come forward for the keynote address.
Better for you to. Yes. Yeah, so you have presented them good.